Now with this, I go over to the document. Incidentally, I am going to ask a query. So I hope you have your clicker devices. Please keep them with you, but do not switch them off right now. I will be asking this question immediately after describing the episode that I mentioned. So in about 10 minutes time, just keep your clickers ready. And the request is for the workshop coordinators to ensure that their receiver machine, receiver hardware is connected and the receiver machine is switched on. This is just to request you to keep things in readiness. I will raise the quiz after about 10 minutes time. So let me now go over. I described to you the use of awk. Strictly speaking, it is not awk that we are talking about. We are talking about the ability to process the data and ability to get the processed result as per our requirements. In particular, we saw how to calculate batch totals, batch averages, and the averages for the entire class. The incidents that I am describing happened when I showed this awk script, and actually I used the data that was processed here in my course last year. So in the class, I announced the names of students scoring high marks in the mid-semester examination. Actually, there is one more person with 44.5 marks. In this slide, the name is missing. I would advise all teachers to consider doing this whenever you conduct an exam for a large class. It is, I think, useful to just mention that these were the top performers because they appreciate it and the students get an element of what I may call desire to do better. Anyway, so I announced the names of students scoring high marks in the mid-sem exam. I asked each one to stand up. There are 800 students, so there was clapping, in fact, where students acknowledged the good performance. Please note that the question paper was out of 45 marks. So even 42 are really good marks, 44.5 were exceptional. Anyway, that is not the point. The point is what happened subsequent to that class is that when I was coming out of the class, one student sitting in front stopped me and said, "Sir, I have a friend who actually should be in the top honors. Currently, his marks are not given like that, but he has raised the issue with his teaching assistant." Remember, our question papers are evaluated by teaching assistants. And he said that after the review, he is sure that his friend will get higher marks and he should be in the honors list. So I did not know anything. I said, "Fine, if that fellow gets his marks elevated to the level above 42, please ask him to send me an email and I'll be glad to include him in the honors list." After that, I got an email from a student. His name was Nitant Vaidya, saying that he has now got his answer book back and the revised total as per the teaching assistant is 43.5. Clearly, he should be in the honors list. But what was most interesting and very touching was in the same email, he further said that before writing this mail to me, he just checked his paper again and found that in the original total that TA had done, he had made a totaling mistake, giving him 2 marks more than what should have been the correct total. And therefore, he said, his final mark should thus be actually only 41.5 and not 43.5, which I should record. These episodes, I think you will all agree, do not happen normally. Our students generally come and fight for increasing marks. It is very rare that somebody comes and admits that evaluation has gone wrong in totaling and the marks are less than what have been shown there. I would like you to appreciate the significance of this admission. Please understand that he is a first year student. Okay, he is ruling himself out from the recognition as a top performer, and in fact the final grade in the course, which by the way often changes with a difference of even 0.5 marks given 800 students, he is jeopardizing that grade. And please understand that as far as we were concerned, our TAs had submitted the modified marks to us. So we had got our records correctly, properly, and in our record, he was shown to have 43.5 marks. And the answer papers were distributed. There is no reason absolutely for him to come back and tell us. So he did it on his own, not because of any compulsion or not at all because there was a fear that he might be discovered. As a teacher, I felt that these admissions are very rare. And coming from a first year student working in a competitive environment, this was indeed exceptional. So I did the following. In the next lecture, I put his name up in an extended honors list. I just said extended honors list, his name, but I did not show any marks. Then I briefly recited this episode and asked the students that irrespective of the marks that he has got, I feel that he should be in the list of top honors. Do you agree? And the whole class agreed actually. Then when I asked him to stand up, as I had asked the other honors people to stand up, for each of whom there was a clapping earlier, believe me, the clapping here was roaring clapping. What I understood is that all our students, like all of us, really respect ethical behavior. I felt glad that I actually did all this because I think it encouraged the students to imbibe some of this ethical behavior. Personally, I believe that it is such episodes which make our lives as teachers very enjoyable and meaningful. More importantly, I think these episodes go a long way to increase our own resolve to be scrupulously ethical in our activities. Remember, we as human beings are very good in quickly noticing the mistakes or the wrong behavior in others. But in our own case, we rarely examine ourselves. I think such episodes tell us to do that constantly. I have found such events very, very not just touching, but very encouraging to ask me to introspect and examine myself. And the last observation I would like to make about this episode is that we often look for role models in life and we search for big names. My humble observation is that role models need not be searched far and wide. They exist amongst us, often disguised as normal people, coming out only through some small events. Please note that even the last 7 days, what I have noticed, look at the interaction, intense interaction that is happening between the participants and the coordinators and the coordinating staff and their colleagues. I know it is happening at many centers, but I find the Nagpur interaction exceptional. Look at our friends in Srinagar. In spite of all kinds of problems, they even are willing to walk or cycle down to the center to attend the classes. Now, these are the kind of events, I think, which tell us a lot. And my conclusion is it is up to us to recognize, acknowledge, and emulate. The word I have used is if we so dare. Because to appreciate is simple, but to emulate, to try to follow it ourselves is difficult. It requires a lot of heart and lot of guts. So if we so dare, we should do that. I'm sorry for having taken 5 minutes of your time. This is completely non-technical. It has nothing to do with C programming. But this episode happened when I was teaching programming to 800 students. From the reaction of the 800 students, I felt that the students appreciated this. And in fact, that perhaps reflected in their subsequent ethical behavior when they themselves were required to do peer evaluation of their colleagues and give marks. When there was no supervision, yet they worked with accountability and with discipline. The only purpose of showing this or sharing this episode with you is that my suggestion to you as colleague teachers that whenever such incidences happen in your classes, and I am sure there will be at least one incident every semester or every year that would be happening, please don't just ignore it or forget it. Try to make a description of that episode. Share it with your own students, share it with your colleague teachers. I think these are very, very enriching experiences which make our life as teachers far more fruitful. So sorry for this digression and we'll get back to our technical stuff back again. So we go back to C programming. Okay. We discuss file processing in C. So far we have seen the scanf and printf functions for basic input output. But if I want to actually handle a file all by myself, not standard input, standard output, how do I do that? So first of all, we understand the basics of a file as seen by a C program. For a C program, a file is defined through a special pointer called file star. So just as we have int star, float star, there is a type called file star, which describes a file pointer which points to a file object. We declare it as file star fp. So fp is a variable, just like I have integer variables and float variables, I have a variable called file pointer. For these files, any file that I use, I have to open that file, I have to read or write to that file, and I have to close that file. A file may contain millions of bytes. The beauty is that in C, I have functions which are capable of positioning inside a file at a particular byte address and is capable of reading or writing at that position. This is exemplified through this small explanation here. So first of all, star fp will point to the file object, but a position pointer which can be made to point to any byte position in the file for random access files. Once I position the pointer, and we shall see how we can position the pointer. Operating system or C does not automatically position it. The responsibility is ours. So we assume, let's say the file has 1 million bytes and I want to position the pointer at exactly 1253rd byte. I can actually do that. Once I position the pointer, then I can read or write as many bytes from that position as I want. And that is what gives me the extraordinary capability of random reading or direct reading and random writing or direct writing. In short, either I can process a file sequentially, in which yes, I will keep reading bytes one after another, or I can process the file by random access. So where I position a pointer, I actually assign a proper value to the pointer, and then I can read or write as many bytes as I want. What we are going to examine is some functions in C which permit us to do that. These are the modes of file opening. As I told you, I must open a file first. A file may already exist, in which case I can open it for reading data from, or appending to it, or read-write both. A file may not exist, but when I open it for writing, a new file is created. A file may be text file, such as the ones in which we handle data through scanf and printf, or a file may be called a binary file. Binary file does not mean that there is a gibberish binary data inside. There could be text data inside. But the general implication is that if I open a file as a binary file and create a file as a binary file, normally the contents of that file cannot be directly examined by an editor. So I might have some internal storage reflected into the bytes that I write in such a file. These are various modes. These modes are used along with the open function call. So whenever I open a file, I can give a flag which is R, which simply says input file for text. RB stands for binary, W for creating or writing output, and WB for writing or creating binary file. So text and binary are the two types of files, if you so wish to call them, and these modes R, W, R plus, R plus B, or RB plus. Similarly, W plus, W plus B, or WB plus, A stands for appending to a file. Remember, I mentioned that when I open a file for writing, there might exist a file, and I can open a file for IO so that I can randomly go to any position and replace existing data by something else by writing there. But ordinarily, I will take a file of some records, and I might want to add records at the end, and that is called appending. So the mode that I will use will be called an append mode. Sequential files in C are very commonly used, and these are exactly like the ordinary sequential files that we have seen. For example, whenever we prepare a file to contain data, whether it is numerical data for matrices or whether there are records of the kind that we just saw, we will generally treat them as sequential files, where we will read or write record by record. This data is read only in a sequence. and therefore the position pointer is essentially automatically managed by the underlying function library. We don't have to explicitly set position. Okay. Whereas, so most text files are treated as sequential files, and formatted input output is usually used for text files. I am here listing all the IO library functions, F open. So I give a file name which has been declared as a file pointer type, the F open function call will open a file, F close function call will close a file. If I say FP is equal to F open my file dot text comma R, then this will actually open a text file for input or for reading. Similarly, I can use that F close call as F close FP. We have seen scanf functions. Scanf works with std in, but if I say fscanf, then the fscanf function has the ability to read from a file. Please note that this is not redirection. One reason for necessity for such function calls is that I can redirect only to std in or std out. But suppose I have a processing requirement where some data is to be read from one file, simultaneously some other data is to be read from another file, simultaneously some other data is to be read from third file, there is no way redirection can help, because redirection redirects only one standard file, either std in, say std in this case. So in I will have to necessarily open multiple files and read data from that. Suppose I want to read data which is formatted and I want to use scanf. How will I do that when there are multiple open files? That is where I use fscanf. I have already indicated that I can use sscanf. This is a function call which does not apply to data in a external file, but it applies to a data in a string. So if I have s as an array which contains a string, then whatever scanf would have done on the input record given either from keyboard or from a file, it will do the same thing to the contents of the string. These are very powerful functions. Exactly the same fashion, I have printf, I have fprintf which will print formatted output to the named file which is indicated by fp, and I have sprintf which will actually use the format specification to create an output inside a string which then I can combine with other strings and output. So it permits variety of options for me to choose from. I already told you gets, which is get string, the fgets fp I have not indicated here, but it will get from a particular file. Gets will get it from a std in. Similarly, put string and f put string. This is the reference I was mentioning to c++.com. This is a site which actually describes a whole lot of details, useful details about C++. But inside that reference, there is a C library. And inside the C library page, there is STDIO, that is standard IO. In that, you will find very complete description of all functions of the C library. Last but not the least, for random access, open and close will be used, will be done using similar functions. But setting up of a pointer is done by a seek command, fseek. The word seek comes from the original disk drive, if you recall that diagram, where on whichever track I have data of the disk, I have to move the arm to that track. That is called seeking the track. So since seeking is some kind of positioning, although there the positioning is only on a track, here we are seeking a specific point in the disk or a byte count. Fseek is that function call. So when I say fseek, it means that take my file fp which I would have already opened, use this offset and push my file pointer to that offset, starting with that offset whence. Okay, I will leave it to you to figure out what exactly, how exactly do you use this fseek. I have some example I think here which we shall see now. Here is reading from a binary file. So I want to read data from binary file. So what I say, f read ptr. Ptr is pointer to a block of memory with a minimum size of size into count bytes. Size is the number of bytes in each element to be read. So please note, I am talking about now blocks like records. So I have one record which is, let's say, 58 bytes long. It depends upon the components of the record. And I want to read a block of memory, okay, with this size into count. So 58 byte records, I want to read 10 such records. So size will be 58, count will be 10. PTR is the pointer, that means the starting position of this block of bytes. And what is stream? Stream is nothing but our FP, which is the name of the file. So what this particular FREAD will do is that based on the PTR, remember what is PTR? PTR is the position inside that file. Obviously, to set the pointer, I must use the seek command to set the pointer appropriately. Once the pointer is set, from that point onwards, so many bytes will be read in one shot by this FREAD command. How many bytes? Size into count. This is an extremely powerful system call which permits us to do a random access. How do I write to a binary file? This is an example. The command is fwrite ptr size count and stream, exactly the same way as fread was. So here is an example, int main file star p file. I am describing a file pointer p file. Now I am describing a character array, char buffer, no size mentioned, equal to character x comma character y comma character z. Incidentally, we have not discussed this feature earlier, but arrays, when they are declared, can also be initialized by giving individual values for individual elements and putting the entire collection in brasses like this. This can be done for numerical value arrays, float, integer arrays. This can also be done for character array. Please note that the size of the array is not declared here. So this buffer 0 will be given value x, buffer 1 will be given value y, buffer 2 will be given value z, and since it's a character array, a null pointer probably will terminate. Now all that I am trying to say is, I open a file which I call myfile.bin. This is entirely my choice, any name that we give. The word .bin does not signify anything to either operating system or C. It is only my way of saying that this file is probably containing only binary data. And I open it for writing in a binary mode. Now notice what I am doing. Write buffer comma size of buffer comma 1 comma p5. So what I am doing here? Size of buffer. Size of is a function in C which gives me the size of any structure. Buffer is an array. I do not know what is the size of buffer. Okay, the size of this array could be 3, 4, 5, whatever it is as per the internal convention. Size of buffer will return me those many bytes. Let us say this is 3 bytes, 5 bytes, 7 bytes, 4 bytes. In this case, it should be 4. 1 is the count. So I am writing exactly 1 unit of 4 bytes at the position indicated by, I am writing this information. This is the block of memory to be written. And I am writing it in P5. Where will it be written? At the current position of the pointer. Since this is the first position, this is the first write statement, it will get written there. I just write this and close this file. Later on by another program, if I open the file and read the first block that I have written, I will get exactly these values. So this is how simple it could be for reading and writing. Some explanation about binary files. As opposed to text files, the data stored in binary files cannot be seen through normal text editors. For example, fingerprint files, for example, digital photographs or audio video recording. Second, even structured records of useful information may be stored in internal binary form in a file if we so wish. So floating point numbers, okay, there are, let's say there is an array of 10 floating point numbers. So instead of converting them into printf or sprintf and taking a string and then storing that that entire formatted string in my file and then calling it a text file, again having to spend time while reading it to reconvert back into internal format, I can simply do the following. I can take the array of floating point numbers and directly write entirely as it is inside a file. I am sure that whenever I read it, it back into the same structure, I will recover the exactly same representation, etc., etc. Such files will have to be declared and processed as binary files. and it is preferable to have fixed size records inside those files. So record is not merely a record in a text file as we saw in case of those mid semester marks. That is a visible record which has visible fields, all text which is either alphanumeric or just numeric or whatever, whatever. However, inside binary files, the total information that you write corresponding to some entity will be called a record, and that record will have certain size. What is being stated here is it is best to have fixed size records. There is an example with which we illustrate this using some sample data of students. This is a different sample data. This data, I have created a text file. Let us say what I have is name, roll number, and I don't know, these may be marks or some third value, some numerical value. There are six values: Milind, Soni, Ranjit, Ashank, Ashita, Vinita, arbitrary names, and some arbitrary numbers have been given. What do we want to do with these? We want to create a binary file and write this data. First of all, we look at the definition of a struct student info. Observe that we have not discussed structure so far. We are going to do that a bit more elaborately tomorrow morning in the first session when we discuss structures and union. But I thought it appropriate to introduce this notion right now itself. First of all, it is not a difficult notion. And secondly, it is important for us to see how it is used in the case of reading and writing to binary files, where we want to put conglomerate records, information about one entity in one shot as a binary data. So look at this. I have defining here char name 31, char roll 9, integer hostel, float marks, character grade. Notice that the input file that I have prepared seems to have only three values. Apparently, the first one is name. Apparently, the second one is roll number. Perhaps the third one is hostel, which is indeed the case. Hostel 3, hostel 1, hostel 11. But there are no marks. And there are five marks. There are five elements for marks. Because there may be five evaluations: quiz, test, assignment, project, whatever, whatever. And finally, there is a grade, which is a three character grade. Now, this all data for each student has to be described as a single group. And I will have how many such data? As many students as I have. Now, observe that individually each of them is a normal variable. But when I define this struct student info, this student info, this is a special definition. So let us see what this struct student info mean. First of all, a structure defines a new type of data value which denotes a collection of several data items. And what is it? Am I defining an actual conglomeration of data? No, it denotes a collection. So the name of the struct as shown in the definition is really an abstract data type. So what I am creating is, just like there are standard data types, int, float. I know int means 4 bytes. I know float means 4 bytes. I know char means 1 byte. Similarly, now student info is a new type that I am creating. So what is student info? Student info is a structure. It's a description of a structure. How many bytes does it occupy? Well, as many bytes as the sum total of bytes occupied by individual components. That is now the type. Remember, whenever I have a type, I have to declare variables or arrays of that type for actual memory allocation to happen. With the definition of struct that we just saw, we can declare variables of this type in our program. For example, having defined student info as a structure, in my program I can say struct student info x. Struct student info is a composite word. It means the data type which I have defined artificially called student info. It is almost similar to saying float y, int z or whatever. Struct student info means x is now a new variable which I am defining, but it is not a simple variable holding an integer or floating point value. Rather, it holds the complete structure which I had defined. Now, this structure has components. The structure had a roll number, name, whatever, whatever, whatever. But once I define a variable, first of all, the compiler allocates enough memory to this new variable of an abstract type called student info, such that all components which were described in the structure are available for referencing as a part of this x, which is the new variable. How do I reference different components of x now? Well, these are referenced by saying, for example, x dot hostel, which will represent an integer value. Remember, role is a character array. Okay, we had said that so many characters constitute a name. Individual element of that character array will be referenced by saying x dot role 2. So dot is the symbol used to say left hand side is a variable of the type structure, right hand side is a particular element that is being referenced. And x dot hostel now can participate in any expression where an integer variable or value can participate. X dot role 2 can participate in any expression where a character value can participate. Similarly, if I have to pass an array to some function or name, use the name of an array, then x dot role will be that name which I will use in that context. Here is an example. Int main struct student info s. So please notice I have defined student info s structure. I am defining s as one variable. I hope to use this variable to store the values of information about one student. Remember, my input file is still a text file. I have to get that data, and hopefully I want to create a database of students somewhere. So to read one record and store it somewhere, I will use this s variable. I might want to read records of all students, store them in an array. Here is an example of defining an array of structures. Struct student info, student list 100. So each element of student list is neither an integer, nor a float, nor a char, but each element is actually a structure. So consequently, just as I have S, student list 0 is some similar to S, student list 1 is similar to S. They all are of the same type, student info. Now, this is a program which I am writing to decide, this is a database program by the way, so an option which is a character variable, it is to be read. I will describe what that option is. I am describing two character pointers star n and star r. I now define integer rec size, which is the record size. The objective of this rec size variable is to denote the total number of bytes that will represent the total data about one student. Since a student is defined in terms of that structure, the rec size should reflect the information about that structure. Similarly, I have a file whose file name I give as batch input file.txt. So this is the file that you have got. Please remember that at the time of definition of an array, such definitions may be possible. What is the rec size? Rec size is equal to size of S. Remember, size S is a variable defined as structure student info. Consequently, this size of operator will return the total number of bytes allocated to the structure S which I have defined of the type student info. Let us go back a couple of pages and see exactly what this would be. Char name 31. The first element is an array of 31 elements. Okay. The second is an array of 9 elements. Both are char. So totally I have got 40 bytes so far. Int hostel, it would typically be 4 bytes. So I have got 44 bytes. Float marks 5. Now this is float, so every element will be 4 bytes. There are 5 elements in this array, total of 20 bytes. Char grade 3, the three elements, so 3 bytes. Consequently, if I declare a variable of the type student info like S, then the total size of the number of bytes occupied by S will be equal to some total of this. And that incidentally is what will be given to me by this size of operator. Here is a function that I write, void print student, struct student info S. So I pass this struct as a parameter, I expect to get it. And I say serial number, it's an artificial serial number. I print for the serial number the name, roll number and hostel of the student, and if I have marks, I print the mark. This is merely a function to actually print the details of a student whose data is stored in that structure. this is the main program which we are discussing, and I was showing you that if I have this rec size equal to size of S, what will it return? So it will return the sum total of bytes allocated to the actual variable S. This variable is a structure. S itself does not directly stand for any individual value, but components of S do. So look at what I am doing now. I open a file by giving the file name which I have already assigned in a value, and I say it is input that is for reading. When I open this file, I do the following. I use the fscanf to read from this file a number. Remember the file format that I gave for input, the first is the total number of students. Then I say I print the data of so many numbers. Now I set up a check. If FP is not equal to null, that means the file was actually open. Please remember that the fopen command will try to open a file. If for some reason I can't open a file, there is no file, for example, I have forgotten or I have given, I am in the wrong directory when I open the file. So I may get an error. If I get an error while opening, the file pointer return is null. You will notice that similar thing happened in some of the functions that we saw earlier. In fact, this is a standard practice in all C functions which return a pointer. If things succeed, they return a proper pointer. If things don't succeed as we wanted, they will return a null pointer. Same thing happens in this case. So if FP is not equal to null, that means everything is all right, file was opened. Now what I do, for I equal to 0 to n, n minus 1 that is, one by one I read the data of all students, and I am using fscanf. Notice that I have opened a file, each line is a text line. So I want to read it as if I am reading it using scanf, but I am using fscanf to read from that file. Percentage, percentage, percent D. Why? Because I am reading a string, another string, and a numerical value. This was a question that somebody had raised. I can read two strings. I want to read them into which variables? I want to read them into two arrays, string arrays, which is name and role, but S dot name and S dot role, because S is the structure. Please note that name and role have no separate existence. In fact, if there is another array defined as with name, then I might be referring to that if I don't use S. Consequently, this particular fscanf, percent S, percent S, percent D, will read values of three variables. The first one is a string, the second one is a string, and the third one is a number. The first string will be read into the array which is referred to by S dot name. Please note that S dot name means the complete array name. This is called typecasting, as I had explained to you. I convert it into a character pointer because the parameter expected here is a character pointer. Similarly, char star S dot role, and for S dot hostel, which is a numerical value, I simply put that pointer that is the address computing ampersand. Since I am not giving as input marks, at this stage I will set marks to all 0. Maybe at the beginning of the semester no marks have been awarded. There is no grade awarded, so maybe I will put star star in the grade. Notice that it's a 3 element array. So I am putting star star in the grade. Normally my grades are AA, AB, AC, CC, DBB, etc. These are actual grades. A star star later on will mean that the student has not been awarded any grade. So this is the how I am reading data for one student, putting it into various components of that structure, assigning zero values for marks because there are no marks, and assigning an artificial star star grade. By executing this particular set of instructions for I equal to 0, I got the first student data. Then I equal to 1, I got the second student data, and so on. When I finish reading all the n students data, I have got in the array student list I. Notice the simple assignment. All these statements collect different components in S. I use the print student function which I have written to print that data. Now I take the entire structure in this variable S and assign it to ith element of an array of structures. So after assembling all the components, I put all of them into this array. Finally, I close the input file. This completes the reading. Let us now look at, okay, this else refers to if there was file pointer return was null. Now I am creating an output binary database file What is the size of each record? The size is rec size. Remember, I already calculated rec size using the size of operator and giving it a structure variable s as a parameter, so that I know exactly how many bytes I should write per record. Creating of database file is so simple. I open a file, I call it db, star db. So db is the name of the pointer that I give. F open db file wb. W is for writing, b is binary file. Simple. So I open this file for writing and I know that it's going to be a binary file. Look at what I am doing. For I equal to 0 to n minus 1, meaning for all the students that I have, I take the data about ith student from the array, assign it to this simple structure variable s. Remember, s also means roll number, name, marks, etc., which have all been set to 0. And all that I do is f write and s, size of struct student info, comma 1, comma db. Db is the file name. It will write one unit of this structure, and what is the size, how many bytes? Size of this. So size of struct student info, and what values from my memory I want it to write? The memory that is pointed to by S. So I have address of S. Notice that I have extracted the actual values to be written in S. Therefore, when I give this command, a record is written in the file. When I write a record, by the way, the position pointer which I mentioned initially is automatically advanced to the next position. So when I execute this in an iteration, one by one, I will write records in my file. Consequently, at the end of this simple loop, I would have written all the records. Having written these records, I can now have some code to read the data about any particular file. Here is the main program now. These are all functions. Main program says struct student info s long int db file pos. Remember, now I want to read randomly, so I am now creating a position variable. It so happens that the normal int is not adequate, so long int is prescribed. This is like a pointer, but not a pointer to an array or any variable. This is the file position pointer. I am going to manipulate it based on which student I want to read. I say integer I, serial number, rec size, test number, etc. I have float test marks, character db file equal to student db dot mean. So student db dot bin is the name of the file which I have used. Again, rec size, size of s, etc. Notice what I am trying to do now. Remember that I have written the student records. First record which was given, I call it serial number 1. I wrote it in the first position, second in second position, third in third position. Although there is a roll number in each record, as far as I am concerned, I am actually counting the position of each record by some serial number. Serial number 1 means first record, serial number 2 means second record, serial number 3 means third record, and so on. Consequently, if somebody wants to retrieve the record of a student, I will ask him at what serial number the data was given. Suppose he says it was 4th. Well, I will read that serial number using a scanf. Purpose is that for the 4th student, somebody, my TA has given marks which I want to allocate and write back into the disk. So I will collect the test number and test marks to be updated, and I will read the test number and test marks in these two variables. This is a very comprehensive functionality program, by the way. So you may want to read it again. Notice now what I am doing in this code. First, I open the db file. Notice that the file has already been created. So I open it for reading and also for writing. This is really called an update operation. I don't want to write arbitrarily, there is no point. The objective is that there is a student record. Somebody gives me the test marks for that student, which do not exist originally. All that I want to do is read that student's record, modify the values of the marks by taking the new values that I have got and rewrite it in that place itself. In that place itself is important, because later on, whenever I read that student's record again, I should get the updated value. See how easily it is done. First of all, I calculate the position of the file pointer. Size of struct student info into SNO. Notice that SNO starts with 0. So I have a 0 as student, first student, second student, etc. Suppose I am looking at the 4th student, I will simply multiply that 4 student by the size, because I know for every student I have written this size. So I know exactly at what point the next student will be. This gives me the DB file pos. Now I use the fseek command, which I had explained earlier. Command means function. So what does fseek do? Fseek says, for this file pointer fp, seek set, that is set the position, that pos in the file that I had shown to you, at a position which is given by DB file pos. So if I am wanting to update the data of the fourth student by these two statements in that binary file, the pointer, file pointer will be set to the beginning of the fourth student's position. Now I simply do an f read, okay, for this fp file pointer. I read one unit of the size of one student's information and store it in the structure variable s. I will print that data. Now I know that the marks have come, which I have read. So I will set up the marks into the appropriate array element of s dot marks. And now I am ready to update the database file. This fseek command merely reconfirms the seek set to the previous position that I had commanded. I will tell you what happens. When I have set a file pointer at a particular position and I give an fseek, I have read so many bytes. I do not want now my file pointer to point to that position, because what I want to do is come back and rewrite this block itself. So this fseek fp seek set will set that pointer to the previous value, and now I fwrite. Fwrite is very simple. Into the file one unit of this information, and what information? And s, the same data which I have read, which I have modified by adding the marks, I am rewriting it. I will confirm the changes in the file by reading it again. So I will again say fseek, same file position, seek set, and fread again. So please note, this is like a verification. I read some record, I modified some values, I rewrote it. I want to check whether my rewriting went to the correct place and correct values were rewritten or not. Simple, I reset the pointer to the beginning of that particular student record inside the file, read that data, print the student's information. I know that everything is okay, and I will close the file. This then is a comprehensive program which A is capable of creating a database file from some input data, which is a binary file. It creates chunks of records. Each record is actually a complete record containing information about a student, which has several components. All these components are described as a part of structure. We saw how a structure is defined. Having created a database file around serial numbers as an artificial unique positioning identifier in the database. Strictly speaking, this is not correct. And in today's lab, I have indicated a discussion session that if instead of a serial number, if somebody tells me, look, this is the roll number of the student, get me the data, how will I handle it? I can handle it by sequentially reading all records, comparing the given roll number and finding out whether that is the roll number or not. But I would like a direct addressing mechanism, which I have got created artificially using a serial number. In any case, what we saw in this program is, first, a database file is created, a binary file. Second, I can now get any student's data. Suppose marks are to be updated, I can read the marks for that student. Given the serial number, I know how to open the database file, I know how to go to the correct position, set the file pointer, read exactly those many bytes of data depending upon the size of the structure for that student into my memory, modify values. Here I am modifying a marks, but I could even say change in hostel, change in anything, whatever. And then I am rewriting it exactly at the same position and then verifying that I have rewritten. In short, what we have done in the last half an hour is really to understood a very rudimentary way of creating a database, accessing the database record randomly, reading that and updating it. It is this problem that we have tried to solve through our understanding of file processing. In short, in this session, we saw simple I/O, which is scanf and printf for text file. We also saw how direct access files and binary files can be handled meaningfully to permit us to do our desired operations on data, particularly when I want to organize data as some kind of a database file, where I have, and this example was only 6 records. The problem that I have asked you to look at in the lab today does not deal with this data, but it deals with the data that you get from that mid-semester file. So, I have asked you to do the following. Treat that as the basic input that you have got and create a database file for those 800 students. You may take a serial number which is there in the input file itself, treat that as the key, roll number, name, etc., you can store. You may additionally want to keep some space in that structure for future marks which may come. There is a lot of imagination that you can do. Please try to write that program. Incidentally, to read that data meaningfully using C, because you won't be using awk script, I have included in the lab today a sample program which was written by one of the students. I think I mentioned it. The student was so enthusiastic. I think Ketav Mehta was his name. So when I discussed this particular problem and awk, within one day he came back saying, sir, I have written a program to calculate the batch wise totals and averages and so on. So why I have included that program? For two reasons. One, to show you what enthusiastic students are capable of doing. He wrote that 300 line program in a single day, tested it and submitted it to me. You may not be able to use that program for the purpose of the lab problem which requires you to create a database file, but you can use much of the statements in that program to read the data from every line, to break it up into different parts, which is what he is doing. Of course, you will have to study that carefully and modify it wherever you want. So use portions of that program to read the data, use the ideas given in this particular program to write into a database file. That is your exercise today. I think with this we are close to this session. There are two more slides. Okay, this is just print all database records. In the main program, I am actually reading all records from the database one by one, because there were 6 records. This is not correct. I should be reading all records using checking whether the file has ended or not. So it could be more complex thing. This is a simple example. But effectively, I read the structure one by one and I print the student's data. So that's it for this session. Thank you. Over and out.